The next topic is about voice. Let's look at the voice characteristics. What is the speech bandwidth? 300 Hz to 3400 Hz. How is speech produced? Human speech is produced by flow of air from lungs. The airflow is forced through the vocal cords, which modulates the airflow by rapidly opening and closing, causing a buzzing sound from which vowels and voiced consonants are produced. The fundamental frequency of vibration is about 110 Hz, 200 Hz and 300 Hz for men, women and children respectively. You can change the size and shape of your oral cavity by moving your lips, tongue, lower jaw and soft palate. Such actions change the relative position of your teeth, tongue and the lips and shape sound into speech or words. In other words, vowels or consonants. The entire mechanism can be thought of as a filter with broad resonances called formants. The frequencies of these formants are controlled by the varying shape of the tract due to movement of tongue, teeth and lips to produce appropriate sounds, for example, by moving the position of the tongue. What is voiced and unvoiced? Look at the waveform in time domain and also frequency domain. The waveform of the utterance speech lab shows time in second along with x-axis and the pressure level on the y-axis. The louder the sound, the greater is the amplitude on the y-axis. The spectrogram is an alternative way to characterize speech. Time is still on the x-axis, but y-axis has the frequency in hertz and intensity is shown by the degree of darkness in the image. Now, voiced speech is considered periodic with a fundamental frequency of F0 and a pitch period of 1 by F0, which depends on the speaker. Hence, voiced speech is generated by exciting the all-pole filter model of a periodic impulse train. For example, take the vowels A, E, I, O, U. These are periodic in nature with a fundamental frequency of F0, which typically characterizes a particular speaker. Therefore, if you need to simulate this artificially, we can design an all-pole filter model and duplicate the fundamental frequency of the speaker by a periodic impulse train. On the other hand, unvoiced sounds are generated by exciting the all-pole filter model by the output of a random noise generator. Take for example, yes. This does not have any periodicity, therefore it is not voiced. It's plain noise. Therefore, consonants like P, T, K, H, etc. can be simulated by exciting an all-pole filter through a random generator. The voice sounds can be artificially generated using a periodic impulse train and the unvoiced sounds can be simulated by using a random noise generator. This is the principle of simulating voice through artificial means. And this is the first step towards compressing the speech. All the codecs that are employed in GSM and CDMA employ this technique and compress the speech to very low values such as 9.6 kilobits per second or 4.8 kilobits per second. Now, let us look at the special properties of speech. There are four major properties. One is high frequency roll-off. Second one is predictability. Third one is stationary or quasi-stationary. The fourth one is silence property, also known as redundancy property. What do you mean by high frequency roll-off in speech? In speech, as the frequency decreases below 500 Hz or increases beyond 2800 Hz, the amplitude or the energy of the speech decreases. There is no significant energy, in fact, below 300 Hz on the lower side or beyond 3400 Hz on the upper side. Therefore, speech bandwidth is from 300 Hz to 3400 Hz. How predictable is speech? What is the predictability property? Where is this property used? Let's answer all these questions. The slope of the speech waveform is graceful and very low in value. For example, if speech is digitized, the adjacent samples will have values very close to each other. Speech cannot have abrupt variations in value. What do we mean by this? If one sample has a value of 2.2 volts, for example, the next adjacent sample will be a very small delta, maybe 2.25 volts. From 2.2 volts, the next sample cannot jump to 3 volts. There will not be abrupt variations in the value. We cannot mimic, in fact, a very sharp sound like that of a simple calling bell or banging the table and making an abrupt noise. These sort of things cannot be mimicked, which shows that the human speech mechanism cannot produce abrupt sound variations. Even something as simple as clicking your fingers cannot be 100% mimicked. Okay, understood. But where is this used? It is used in speech compression and speech codecs to a very large extent. If the current sample value is known, the next sample will be within a small delta, and therefore it is absolutely predictable. This property is exploited in the speech compression, especially in the GSM and CDMA mobile communications. Let us look at the next property, namely stationary property of speech. The short-term energy of speech does not vary significantly and remains stationary. So what is the definition of short-term? It is typically up to 20 milliseconds interval, 10 milliseconds to 20 milliseconds. The energy may vary between two adjacent 20 millisecond segments, but not within a 20 millisecond segment. This property also is exploited extensively in speech processing, especially in the GSM and CDMA communications. The speech is handled always in segments of 10 or 20 milliseconds in GSM and CDMA. Let's look at the third property. What do we mean by silence property of speech? Silence property, as we said, is also known as redundancy property. While we speak, you will be surprised to know that we are active for only approximately 40% of the time and we are silent for 60% of the time. It's a little difficult for us to believe, but that's the way it is. The silent zones, where all they occur, it will be on account of pauses between two syllables, between two words, between sentences, between thought processes, etc., etc. The pauses also occur when we think in between what next to say or while we are listening to the other person, etc. For example, if the other person is talking continuously for 2 minutes, we are silent for 2 minutes. The GSM CDMA coders exploit this property also extensively for compressing the speech further. The coding takes place only when the speech is active and no coding takes place when the speech is silent. The bitrate reduction is almost by 50%. Let us look at some interesting statistics. What is the audible range of human beings and other animals and birds? Human beings can hear between 20 Hz to 20,000 Hz. It's more like 15,000 Hz, but some textbooks quote 20,000 Hz. Any sound with a frequency below the audible range of hearing, that is less than 20 Hz, is known as infrasound. And any sound with a frequency above the audible range of hearing, that is more than 20,000 Hz, is known as ultrasound. It will be interesting for us to know, dogs can hear between 50 Hz to 45,000 Hz. That is why dogs are watchdogs. Cats can hear between 45 Hz to 85,000 Hz. Bats as high as 120,000 Hz. Dolphins up to 200,000 Hz. While dogs, cats, bats and dolphins have an unusual ability to detect ultrasound, an elephant possesses the unusual ability to detect infrasound, having an audible range from approximately 5 Hz to 10,000 Hz. Look at the figure. This shows a voice coder with a PCM codec. PCM has already been seen a few slides back in detail. We'll learn about voice codecs in a short while. These codecs are extensively used in GSM, known as regular pulse excitation long-term prediction, RPE, LTP, and in CDMA, CELP, and EVRC codecs. We shall see some of them elsewhere in this module. Let us now look at speech modeling through artificial means, mostly through computers. There are four processes. One, to start with, an input sample of the speaker is analyzed and his pitch is extracted. Two, the segments in which the speaker produced voiced sounds like A, E, I, O, U, etc. is computed. The segments where he produced unvoiced sounds, K, S, T, etc. is also computed. The computer also models the anatomy of the speaker, in particular throat, lips, tongue and the teeth, into a filter model for every 20 milliseconds segments in a dynamic fashion. Now we are ready to model the person's speech artificially. We start with a pulse oscillator with a period equal to the pitch of the speaker and also a noise source. A switch selects either the oscillator or the noise source matching the previously computed voiced and unvoiced segments. That is, wherever we have detected voiced segments, the oscillator is deployed, and wherever we have detected unvoiced segments, a noise source is deployed. The output is passed through the computer dynamic filter and the resultant output will be as good as the speaker's original speech. This is how speech is modeled artificially. In this slide, let us look at a comparison between voice and data. The table is quite detailed, therefore, any further explanations are considered to be redundant. Please look at the table and understand the various characteristics of voice and data. In this module, let us look at parametric coding. So this is a different family of codecs. Now what is parametric coding? This family of codecs derives the basic physiological parameters of speech and transmits them. This process of parameter extraction is called parametric coding. The typical parameters are pitch, voiced, unvoiced instances of speech, and the physiological model of the human vocal tract as a filter, which consists of throat, tongue, teeth, and lips. Please note that speech pattern changes every 20 milliseconds, and therefore, all these parameters are computed in a dynamic fashion every 20 milliseconds and transmitted continuously. Okay, as against this, what is waveform coding? Waveform coding codes a waveform slope, amplitude versus time, of the speech signal as it occurs, and does not worry about extracting the speech parameters. In other words, it attempts to code and decode the waveform accurately and exactly as it happens. Let us look at some parametric codecs now. The first one is channel vocoder. Please look at the figure. The channel vocoder employs a bank of bandpass filters. The speech is segmented into typically 10 or 20 millisecond segments. The vocoder has 16 to 20 filters, bandpass filters, each with a bandwidth of 100 to 200 cycles. We know that the input speech has different levels of energy in the speech frequency band of 0.3 to 3.4 kHz, and this energy spectrum varies in a dynamic fashion every 20 milliseconds. The vocoder picks the energy in each of these bands through this narrow bandpass filters and maps the complete spectrum of speech as an energy profile. The output of each filter is rectified and low pass filtered. These outputs are multiplexed and transmitted. Therefore, the output of these filters represent what is known as the spectrogram, that is energy versus frequency of speech, every 20 milliseconds. Two important characteristics of speech are the voice detection and pitch estimation. Therefore, a voice unvoiced detector and a pitch estimator are also included in the vocoder. These parameters are also transmitted. Now look at this figure where we talk about a decoder. At the receiver, the energy signals are demultiplexed, passed through a digital to analog converter, and the output of these DTAs are multiplied by the voiced or unvoiced signal sources and finally fed to the appropriate bandpass filters. Please note, the arrangement of these bandpass filters, their center frequencies, cutoffs, etc. have to be exactly same as that of transmitter. The output of these filters, when you sum up, gives the synthesized speech signal. That is the original speech. This parametric codec is known as channel vocoder. Let us look at one more type of parametric coding called LPC. What is LPC? LPC stands for linear predictive coding. The definition is linear prediction is a method where future values of a signal is estimated as a linear function of a string of past samples or previous samples. The past history is used to predict the future samples. The model says that the digital speech signal is the output of a digital filter called the LPC filter, whose input is either a train of impulses or a white noise sequence. Train of impulses occur whenever the speech segment is voiced, and white noise occurs whenever the speech segment is unvoiced. LPC assumes that speech is produced by a buzz through a tube. Let us briefly now recall the speech production mechanism here. The glottis, that is the space between the vocal folds, produces the buzz. The loudness and pitch are the characteristics of this buzz. The vocal tract is formed by the throat and mouth, and this is in the form of a tube. This tube will have its own resonances called formant frequencies. In a typical speech profile, there will be at least four such formant frequencies. Hisses and pops are generated by the action of the tongue, lips and throats during plosives. Now what is plosive? Take the letter P for example. How do you produce this P? Close your lips and build up the pressure of air inside and suddenly release it. So these sort of sequences like P, B, they are called plosives. Let's now look at the LPC block diagram. Look at this figure. LPC consists of the following steps. 1. Pre-emphasis filtering. 2. Data windowing. 3. Autocorrelation parameter estimation. 4. Pitch period and gain estimation. 5. Quantization. And 6. Decoding and frame interpolation. We'll briefly look at some of these blocks. Pre-emphasis filtering. Why is this required? Speech has got a high frequency roll-off. Higher frequencies have lower energy. In other words, bulk of the speech energy is concentrated in the lower frequencies. Therefore, a pre-emphasis is applied to boost high frequency signals to even out the energy distribution. Next is data windowing. Speech energy remains quasi-stationary, does not change significantly for short durations such as 20 milliseconds. Therefore, LPC process takes advantage of this property. LPC is done on input segments of 20 to 30 milliseconds data windows. The third one is determining pitch period. LPC determines if the speech is voiced or unvoiced. the residual signal prediction error is analyzed for its periodic nature. LPC analyzes the speech signal by first estimating the formants, that is the formant frequencies, which are estimated and then transmitted, to removing their effects from the speech signal through inverse filtering. 3. In the remaining bus called the residue, estimate the loudness, that is the gain, and also the pitch. 4. The residue or excitation is approximated during voicing by a quasi-periodic impulse train and during unvoicing by a white noise sequence. This approximation is called EN. What are the parameters LPC transmits? The formant frequencies, the loudness estimation, the pitch, and the residue signal. They are all digitized as numbers and then transmitted. At the receiver, LPC synthesizer reconstructs the speech by revising the process. First, uses loudness and pitch parameters to get the buzz. Next, uses the residue to create a source signal. Next, uses the formants to create a physiological filter which represents the tube, tongue, teeth, lip and throat. 4. Passes the source signals voiced and unvoiced segments through the filter at appropriate pitch to reconstruct the speech. This process is done on short segments of speech signal, typically 10 to 20 milliseconds. The objective of LP analysis is primarily to estimate parameters of an all-pole model of the vocal tract.